जर्नलिज्म. ओके, सो अ गुड रिपोर्टर नेवर एक्सपेक्ट्स एनी डायरेक्शंस. ही नेवर एक्सपेक्ट्स एनी डायरेक्शंस फ्रॉम हिज बॉस. ही नेवर एक्सपेक्ट्स एनी डायरेक्शंस विच विल टेल हिम गो टू दिस प्लेस, कलेक्ट दिस न्यूज, कलेक्ट इट इन दिस मैनर एक्सेट्रा. ही विल डू इट ऑन हिज ओन. ही विल एक्सेप्ट द असाइनमेंट्स विलिंगली, वेयर ही हैज टू गो, विच न्यूज ही हैज टू कलेक्ट. All these things he will do on his own accord because he is always on the lookout, searching for news, for new ideas. And perhaps when he comes across new ideas, good news, he will immediately catch it and try to report it to the paper, which will finally release it to the public. And he has to look for the facts, and he has to be very careful not to make enemies of the people by putting forth terms in wrong methods. He should take care enough not to offend or antagonize people by putting forth things in a misleading way. In a mis he shouldn't he should be careful about misrepresentations because he is working in a public domain. He should take care and not hurting the sentiments of the public. At the same time, he respects the right to privacy. Okay, so where, especially when he is writing about private people, about people, he should respect the right to privacy. So a reporter who's a very important person who gives news to the newspaper should have the sense of proportion. He should have the understanding ability, the comprehensiveness. And he should know very well what issue, and he should look at all sides of the issue. He has to be a very wise person. He has to be a very fair person, and go about. Then we have part three, which is called as news lead. What is this news lead? News lead means the topic sentence that attracts us, the story, which makes us feel attracted to read that story. That is the important part. So, what is this lead? News lead means the first paragraph of any news which will tell you everything about that news. The first paragraph which will tell you everything about that news. So, that is called as lead. That is called as lead. So, the lead means what? The important point of that entire news. Okay, the important point of that entire news, it can be up to 25 to 30 words. So the lead, the news lead will be the heart of the news story. A person, if he is interested in reading that news, the very opening part, the paragraph, the opening paragraph will attract that person to read that news lead. So how to write that? So you have actually three parts. The lead is the first part. The lead is the lead or introduction, lead or intro. Okay, that is the first one. And then you have in the body of the writing, you have a logical flow of thought. And thirdly, you have the different methods of writing. First, you have the lead, which gives you the story of what that news is going to be about. Then you have the body, and then finally, you might be having the conclusion. So the lead should be more clear. It should not have any complex elements in it. Clarity should be there. And more than being verbose, more than using hi-fi words or verbosity, you should make it simple and make it easy for the readers. So that will be the opening paragraph. That is all about lead. When it comes to the body of that paragraph or body of that news, then that again, it should highlight very important things like speeches, and it should be in chronological order, time oriented, etc. So they have given some 3 points here. The highlight method is employed in case of speeches. Chronological method is used to report crime and official procedures. And in the inverted pyramid, the most important item comes at the beginning. So they have given some three methods. Okay, the three methods for writing the body of the news. So the first method is highlight method, where you are highlighting things, especially in the case of speeches, etc. You highlight certain things for easy understanding of the public, of the reader. Then you have the chronological method, one incident after another, how it happened on the basis of time, on the basis of period, you record it. Okay. So first method is highlight method. Second method is the chronological method, and third one is the inverted method, where the most important item comes in the beginning, and the latter part uses for the later items. Okay, so these are the different methods of writing the body. Then they say the 5 W's and 1 H forms news. So what are these 5 W's? In Sun TV and other things, you have this. Who, where, what, when, why. So if you get the answer to these different questions, WH questions, W questions, and 1 H question, who, what, when, where, why, who did this, when did this happen, what happened, where did this take place, why did this take place, how did this take place, if answers are given to all these questions, then there forms the news. So you should remember this, these 5 WH questions and 1 H question. So answers to these questions form news. Okay. Sir, can I continue or should I stop, sir? Sir, should I continue or should I stop because I have another class? Hello, sir. Okay. Or maybe we can look at these. Just a few more points are left. You can also read the things about leads, the main types of leads from page 27, where they say you have the feature lead and then the interpretative lead. A feature lead, see, you have around 1, 2, 3, 4, four types of leads. Okay, it's given with examples. When you read these, you'll have a clear understanding. So, what is this feature lead? It starts with the comments on the nature of the writer. I told you, the 5 questions and 1 H question, W question and H question. If it answers to these, then it is a feature lead. Okay. And then interpretative lead. It starts with an interpretation. The news itself starts with a comment or with an interpretation. And then you have something called as question lead. Question lead starts with a question. Direct quotation starts with a quotation. Okay. And then the summary lead summarizes the key points in the story. Then you have something called as descriptive lead, which is more descriptive in style. Okay, it uses colorful and poignant events written in a very colorful language, descriptive manner. And then you have staccato lead. Staccato means short clipped phrases. So that it has, I mean, this is designed in such a way that it is called as staccato lead. And then you have something called as figurative lead. So this lead uses figures of speech. And you have something called as oddity lead. Oddity means strange. Okay, so the very opening will be in a very peculiar manner, started in a strange or peculiar manner, which will create the interest of the reader to read that news. Then you have something called as punch or cartridge lead, which is a very short lead but which has a very rich news. Okay, something like the chief minister is dead. Immediately people will be attracted to that news. So that is called as punch lead. So, who are these suppliers of news? So, you have some four agencies supplying news to the newspapers. So, these suppliers are news are the Press Trust of India, okay, the Press Trust of India, and then United News of India, United News of India, and in Hindi, you have something called as Hindustan Samachar, Samachar Bharati, etc. And you also have some international news agencies like Reuters and Agence France-Presse and United Press International, who sell news to the other news agencies. Okay, so what is the function of these news agencies? These news agencies will survey news and provide news reports of current events to newspapers and to others who subscribe to its service. So I'll stop with this. We'll look at the remaining things during the next class. Thank you.
Good evening.
I think I'm addressing the second year MA English. We'll shortly move on to the text. Please give me a second. So, yes, sir.
Sir? Okay, ma'am, you can continue, ma'am.
Ah, yes, sir, yes, sir. So, Shakespeare, so today we will deal with the great tragedies, Othello, Macbeth, and Hamlet, with a small introduction to drama. Okay. So, since we are dealing with tragedies in particular, I think we'll do some talking about tragedy. So, the great tragedies. So, what is drama? Maybe we can begin with that. So, drama is one of the earliest genres of literature. Poetry needs a lot of stylistic elements. Poetry needed a lot of composure. But when it comes to drama, it came along with human experience. So, drama was a part of a projection of human experience. How? Drama is one of the earliest genres of literature, and every human being has an inherent impulse to pretend, or that someone or something else, or see such a pretension. So, so it is nothing but an, when I said projection of human sensibility, human ability, so when human beings pretend, that's actually drama, and that so drama could easily form a great part. And there were other forces which helped in the development of drama as a as an art form. Drama is unique and different from the other literary genres because drama is a community art. Drama is not just about one person writing and so many people reading, but it's the action performed by so many people. It involves many people, it involves the lives of many people, it involves the actions of many people, and it also sometimes involves the a particular level of understanding with the audience. So the audience relate themselves to some of the characters, the audience relate themselves to some of the experiences that are being enacted on stage. So unlike the other literary genres, which can be produced by an individual in solitude, a poet can sit alone and write his poetry, prose writer, an essayist, all of them can sit alone and write, but never a drama artist. Even if he does it alone, he has to enact it in the middle of many people, and it has to involve so many people, a community. So it's called a community art. Drama is intended to be performed, not just read like any other literary genre. So many people have spoken about drama, they have commented about the drama. Aristotle says it represents people in action. So according to Aristotle, drama represents people in action. So it involves so many people. Marston says drama is read to be spoken, not read. You can't sit and quietly read drama. It has to be spoken by many people, enacted on stage. And Moliere says dramas are made to be played, not read, enacted. The same idea is being said. Boulton, another expert, says drama is literature that walks and talks before our eyes. It's not just lived or experienced. It is drama walks and talks before our eyes. That's the kind of literature that drama is. So what are the origins of drama? Drama simply originated certainly in religion. Drama started with religion. Then it moved on to rustic festivals, like festivals in a village, in honor of the local gods. Later on, it became formal. So in the beginning, it was in the under the power, under the domination of the of religion. So in the first kind of place were founded in the Greek theaters. Greek theater comes first. So theater attendance, so what happens in Greek theater? Why did Greek theater flourish? So the reason for the flourishing of Greek theater is, in fact, attending a Greek theater means you are a citizen of Greece. Any citizen of Greece, any worthy citizen of Greece should have attended a Greek theater. That was the norm. So in order to, you know, feel like a citizen, Greek people had to attend the theater. They attended the theater. And Usually, it is not a single play. Three plays were interlinked. They were called trilogies. So, trilogy is three plays. So, there was a very minimal costume and no properties. No set property was all, were used in Greek theater. So, Greek theater started like this. Masks were worn to represent characters. A man or a woman or a demon or an angel. And men played the role of women. I think all of us know this. Women were not allowed on stage. So, men used to dress up like women and play. So, there are so many things. Amphitheaters were the first kind of theaters. Amphitheater was the first one, and thespis was a theater person. So a theater person was called as thespis. And what were the kind of plays? There was the audience were huge in number, and there were a few people who played the parts. And who were the great dramatists of this time? Aeschylus, Sophocles and Euripides were the great trio of the Greek theater. They were the best. They were an exemplary dramatist who started drama, who kickstarted the entire genre called drama in Greece. So their plays were huge in number. And you have Sophocles also following them. And of course, next comes Aristotle. So Aristotle's plays were the next in line. And Aristotle started with his poetics. So Aristotle's poetics was the first formally written rules and regulations for drama. Aristotle's poetics, it is a treatise. It's a treatise. It is a prose text. So Aristotle's poetics is the title of the text. It is a treatise on drama. Treatise means rules and regulations of drama. And even till date, we quite often find followers of this particular method of drama. These rules are still being followed, at least to a particular extent. So Aristotle's most demanding and rewarding text is Poetics. And Poetics continues to be the central document for the study of aesthetics of drama. Any student who wants to study the aesthetics of drama starts with Aristotle's Poetics. So Aristotle's Poetics recognizes Aristotle's poetics is closely connected to tragedy. Since we are dealing with tragedy today, I'm using this. So Aristotle recognizes six elements of tragedy, meaning namely plot, character, diction. This is an important aspect. Aristotle in poetics, in the book Poetics, Aristotle recognizes six most important elements of tragedy. I'm not talking about drama, but I'm talking about tragedy. Plot is very important. Character is very important. Diction, thought, spectacle, and song. Plot is the skeleton. Character is the role played by all the characters. Diction is the language used. Thought is the basis, one line of thought used. What is the background of the action? Spectacle is how is it presented, and song is another supporting element that we find in place. So these are the most important elements of a tragedy, and he insisted on three unities. This is very important when you talk about Aristotle's rules in poetics: unity of action, unity of place, and unity of time. A play has to have a unity of action. Action should take place within a particular time. Action should take place within a particular place. There are rules and regulations. And the unity of time. Action should take place within a particular given time. So all of them were important, and he insisted upon all of them. He gave importance to, still we are talking about tragedy, I'm not talking about just plays. So according to him, he gives importance to hubris. He says excessive pride in a character called hubris is the term he uses, can be the reason for the tragedy of any character. Hubris, excessive pride in a person's character. And hamartia is the term he uses to denote the tragic fall that occurs because of fate. A hero faces a tragic fall in a play because of his fate, and that is called hamartia. So there are many examples to that. We are not going into the examples. And Aristotle defines another term called catharsis. Catharsis means purgation. Purgation is bringing out a strong emotion, an emotion in excess. In those days, people used to have the four humors in a human body. Even to these days, we have Kaba, Vada, and all that. So all the four humors were in a human body. When one humor becomes more, then the person suffers an imbalance. To fix that imbalance, a little blood was let out. Purgation took place. Purgation is letting out the excess. Excess blood in a particular humor is let out so that the balance takes place and the human being becomes normal. Okay, so similarly, Aristotle defines catharsis as purgation. Here only two emotions are dealt with, pity and fear. The feeling of pity and fear, the emotions of pity and fear have to be in a balance. When they are in an imbalance, then there is a problem with the character. That is the particular problem that all the tragic heroes in Shakespeare's play and all suffer. So there is a purgation of emotion during the course of the plot. At one point, there is a purgation of pity or fear. Excess pity and excess fear is let out. That is called catharsis, purgation. Removing that excess is called catharsis. And then there is another term, anagnorisis. Anagnorisis means a reversal and recognition. The characters who have suffered a tragedy, maybe the main character, maybe the hero or the protagonist of a play, he suffers from, he realizes what has happened in the course of the action. There is a recognition of the truth. He has been blind, maybe the hero or the protagonist was blind about the truth because of his flaw, his tragic flaw. And suddenly there is a recognition. His eyes open and he becomes clear about the truth, the truth that is existing. So that clarification that he gets, that recognition that he has, that understanding that he at one point comes in his life, that is called anagnorisis. He discovers the truth. He recognizes the truth. So from being ignorant, he becomes knowledgeable. The hero, the protagonist, or anybody. So that is called anagnorisis. All these are terms introduced by Aristotle to refer, and all of them refer to tragedy. I'm not talking about drama, I'm talking about tragedy. So, of course, there are other, a few more terms. Peripeteia. Peripeteia. So that means reversal of the fortune of the hero. The hero who was very good for a particular time, or a hero who was very bad for a particular period of time, now suddenly reverses his role. The hero suddenly becomes the villain of the plot. The villain, the so-called villain of the plot, whom all of us audience have been understanding as the wrong person or the villainous person, now becomes the hero. There is a role reversal. So role reversal, this is called a peripeteia, the reversal of fortunes. Then towards the end, you have something called denouement. So denouement is a resolution or the conclusion. Final part of the play has a denouement. Denouement means action comes to an end. Finally, if it is a tragedy, the audience face a lot of death. So with that, the play comes to a resolution. So this is what Aristotle has stated. This is what we find in Aristotle's Poetics. Now, next we move on to Renaissance drama. So from the Greek theater, we move on to Renaissance drama. In Renaissance drama, we have the beginnings of English drama. One second, please. So the period of medieval drama, in the beginning we had medieval drama, follows the fall of the Roman Empire in the 5th century and continues as a Renaissance movement in Europe in the middle of the 5th century. So first we had Greek drama, now we move on to Renaissance drama. Renaissance drama marks the beginnings of English drama, but we don't come to English drama immediately. We first start with, we strongly have the church coming in and taking charge of plays and dramas. So the first kinds of play were called mystery plays and miracle plays. So they were religious plays. Simply put, mystery plays and miracle plays are religious plays, and they found their beginning in France. And as the title goes, since they are religious, they narrated the lives of Jesus Christ and Virgin Mary. So this was a subject matter. It was strictly under the control of the priests. Drama could not detach itself. No individual experience could be recorded. No individual opinion could be done. It was totally under the domination of the church. And towards 1300, the playwrights managed to free their dramas from the clutches of the church. And then they moved on to the marketplaces and became independent. Of course, there was a lot of criticism because the church accused that the plays have become crude and very, very extremely bad and vulgar. But the playwrights did not bother about that. Then came the morality plays. So when we spoke about mystery plays and miracle plays exclusively from the church, the subject matter was religion. Morality plays came up. Morality play was one step a little away. It was an evolution of English drama. So there, lot of allegory was employed. Allegorical characterizations were employed. Abstract characterization was employed. One character was named Mercy. One character was named Wisdom, Peace. Such qualities, good qualities and bad qualities, were enacted on stage. So it was a little away from church. And of course, there was a lot of criticism about this from the church. The morality plays too enjoyed a lot of popularity. Of course, there were crude and farcical elements. The church called it vulgar. For example, Marlowe's Dr. Faustus is an example of it. God, bad angel, good angel, devil, all that was used in that. So Marlowe's Dr. Faustus has a lot of characteristics of this kind of plays. Next came interludes. So this is the last, before English drama, proper English drama, interludes came. Interludes were short plays with the characters such as citizens or monks. There was no allegorical representation of good, bad, virtue, vice and all that. No allegorical representation. Allegorical representation means symbolic representation. Only such plays had allegorical representations. Interludes did not have that. There were a lot of farcical elements and used to be songs also. Songs were slowly introduced. These plays were performed in the courts for entertainment, courts of the kings for entertainment. And of course, it was also being criticized because slowly drama went out of the hands of the priests and the church. Right. Next comes English Renaissance. English Renaissance, the term English Renaissance was used by the French historian Jules Michelet in his book Histoire de France. Of course, with this, we start English Renaissance in playwriting. So Renaissance, when I use the term Renaissance, it is an effort for the individual, for the cry of freedom, freeing oneself from rigid institutions like feudalism and church. Feudalism, rule of great rich people, and rule of the church, all of them. So all these people who wanted freedom for all of that, people whose war cry was freedom and individualism, they supported this Renaissance movement. There was a development in science and technology, and people became doubtful about the existence of God. It is when Renaissance became famous, and Renaissance drama also took high point. So people started to learn, live, think, and question things. This was very important. Individualism was the hallmark of this particular age. Questions were raised. Man wanted to become a free individual without the rules and regulations and the directions given by the church. So this was one important aspect, and we find a reflection of this in pre-Shakespearean period. So this was actually, next comes the pre-Shakespearean period after the Renaissance. Renaissance came in, and Renaissance was a turning point of events in the history of English drama. So dramatists during this time, pre-Shakespearean period, they imitated the classical attitudes, and English drama got its five-act structure, five-act plays. So that was the beginning of five-act plays, was the beginning of this pre-Shakespearean period. The first tragedy came in. Only then they wrote the first tragedy. The first tragedy, the title of the first tragedy is Gorboduc, G-O-R-B-O-D-U-C, Gorboduc, written by Thomas Sackville and Thomas Norton. this is very, very important. So, first tragedy of English literature, English tragedy is Gorboduc by Thomas Sackville and Thomas Norton. So, let's not move to the first comedy. Then it was highlighted by the introduction of the university wits, seven great men, real fashioners of drama. They are called the university wits. In the year 1576, the seven great men, dramatists, who were the real fashioners of drama, they were called the university wits. There is a small list: Thomas Lodge, Robert Green, Thomas Kidd, John Lyly, or Lyly, Thomas Nash, George Peel, and Christopher Marlowe. So I think all of us know Marlowe. They were popularly called as university wits because they were well-read and they were educated in the universities of Cambridge or Oxford. They were educated in the universities of Cambridge and Oxford. All of them were actors and dramatists. They began the groundwork for all of them. They were free-spirited and they were very careless. They were ungodly and they were highly anti-establishment in their attitude. They did not approve of any rules and regulations. So certainly church, feudalism, the rich masters, kings, all of them were totally out of question for them. So they had nothing to do with these seven university wits. They laid a sure basis for English literature or English drama. Then comes Shakespearean theater. Shakespearean period is also called as the Elizabethan age. So Shakespeare was the one person who skillfully managed to bring this as a totally new venture. He was a revolutionary like Marlowe. He violated all rules and regulations laid down by Aristotle. So Aristotle's rules and regulations form the basis of any dramatist and his art. But Shakespeare, like Marlowe, one step ahead, he refused to obey any rules and regulations of tragedy set up by Aristotle. He had his own rules and regulations. Of course, there were some relevance. There was some relationship, but still. So with the rise of Christianity, drama changed, and there was a lot of moralistic upholding and poetic justice had to be served at the end of every drama. Virtue was rewarded, vice. Virtue means goodness was rewarded, vice evil was punished. This is what happened at the end of every drama. But with the emergence of Shakespeare, dramas went back to classical. In his plays, the bads are punished, but the goods also suffer. So it's not that good people don't suffer. So he made slight changes. He brought back the psychological complexity of the Greek plays, which were not found in Aristotle's plays. That is, should I do it or should I not do it? The confusion in a human brain, a human mind, the complication that a human being experiences, doubts, confusions, psychological trauma, all that things were introduced by Shakespeare in his plays, not found in not much spoken about by Aristotle. Now Shakespeare brought back everything. He brought in everything. His was a total package, full of suppressed fear, diabolism. Diabolism means total poisoning, venomous nature, human beings changing into animals. One of the tragedies explains that extremely well. Criminals, racists you find in Othello, Jews, cannibals, they have the canvas of, he had the canvas of life. Everything, all characters were found in his, all kinds of characters were found in his place. So theaters during the times of Shakespeare was really a welcome sight, and the identity of Shakespeare became very strong. The features of Shakespearean tragedy. What are the basic tenets of Shakespearean tragedy? Shakespeare's tragic heroes fall from their good fortune due to some fault called hamartia. All of Shakespeare's tragic heroes, I'm not talking about all heroes, tragic heroes. We have Othello, Macbeth, Hamlet, and King Lear. All of them had their own flaw, a tragic flaw. The tragic flaw is called hamartia. So they fall from their great position only because of the tragic flaw. Othello had his suspicion. Macbeth had his procrastination. He was not able to take decisions immediately. Hamlet, no, Macbeth was ambitious. Macbeth was extremely ambitious. He wanted power, so he fell. Hamlet was, procrastination. Hamlet was not able to take a decision immediately. That was his problem. That brought about the tragedy. King Lear. King Lear was too passionate. Loving too much, hating too much, everything to the extreme. So he fell. So they all fall because of one flaw. That is called Hamartia, all the characters. Tragic heroes are neither saintly nor evil. They are an in-between. They have good characters as well as bad vices. None of them are saintly. None of them are so pure and clean in their characterization. Othello is good as well as bad. So is Macbeth, Hamlet, and King Lear. King Lear is a very loving father, but he was senile. He was old. He was not able to take a balanced decision. So was Hamlet, Macbeth, and Othello. Let's move on later to them. The tragic heroes are of great stature. King Lear, as the title goes, is a king. Othello is a commander. Macbeth is a great soldier, thane of Cawdor. Macbeth is a thane of Cawdor. Later he wants to become the king. That is where the problem comes. Hamlet is the Prince Hamlet. But Prince Hamlet is ready for the throne. The throne is actually open to him. But still, because of his procrastination, he's not able to take a decision, work out a decision immediately, not putting his thoughts to action. That was his flaw, and so the tragedy happens. So they are all great people. They are great stature. They are of great rank, wealth, kings, leaders, influential public figures. All of them fall. So only because they are very high in their status, their fall becomes very horrible. If they are an ordinary soldier, then it may not happen. Next. what is common about all of them? In Shakespearean tragedies, character is destiny. Only because of their character, the tragedy takes place. If they don't have that particular character, then the tragedy simply will not occur. So all of them have the same flaw. So King Lear is very passionate, too much hatred, too much love. Hamlet is character is not able to take a decision immediately. Procrastination, putting off taking decisions. Macbeth, very ambitious, extremely ambitious. It is his character, so he falls. And that is his destiny. He has to fall because he is very ambitious. Othello is doubtful, a lot of doubts, skepticism. He is not able to believe people. Integrity, he can only doubt. So he falls because of that. So character is destiny in all of Shakespeare's heroes. The role of supernatural elements, ghosts, witches, voices that come from the heaven, all of them are very important in his scepters. All of them are very important in Shakespeare's plays, especially in tragedy. And they hasten the action. They hasten the tragedy to take place. So, of course, we can discuss later, but as an example, Macbeth is ambitious. Macbeth is a great warrior. Macbeth is a respected warrior. He was fine, but three witches appear in front of him one fine day. And when they prophesy three things, they say one day you will become, first step, you will become Thane of Cawdor. That is one step ahead from being a commandant in the army of the king, King Duncan. The next is you will become the emperor itself. You will become the king itself. So only because of first step, he becomes Thane of Cawdor because the king is very, King Duncan is very happy about him. So as soon as he becomes Thane of Cawdor, this guy beast begins to believe in the witch's prophecy. He begins to believe in the witch's words. So he thinks, okay, first step happened naturally. Next step, I will do it. I will see that if King Duncan is alive, then I will not become king, the king. So next step is, I will kill Duncan. I will kill all the witnesses. I'll try to kill his chief. I'll try to kill his sons. So there will be no doubt or there will be no problem in me becoming the king. So that is what happens whenever the supernatural elements occur. And in the case of Hamlet, Hamlet is unhappy because his father is dead. Hamlet is shocked because his uncle marries his mother, and his mother also is all right about the marriage, and his uncle marries and becomes the king. But only when the supposed ghost of his father comes and says, "You are not going to become the king," does he begin believing that there is foul play. So this the arrival of the supernatural elements, or the role that supernatural elements play in this in the tragedies, is an important element in Shakespeare's tragedies. So Shakespeare's tragedy begins with order but ends in chaos. So there is a lot of order and organization in action when Shakespeare's tragedies start, but towards the end you see a lot of foul play, lot of action, lot of bloodshed. A bloodied stage is what you feel and you see at the end of a Shakespearean tragedy. Fate plays an important role in his plays. Chance, opportunity also plays an important role in Shakespeare's stage. This brings dramatic irony into effect. And one more thing is, there is no poetic justice in the world of Shakespeare. Hamlet was wronged. Hamlet was wronged by his own uncle. His uncle killed his father, married his mother, and became the king. But Hamlet was a good person. But Hamlet is also killed in the end. So there is no poetic justice. So the good person lives and the bad person is punished. That rule and that law is not followed in Shakespeare's tragedy. Right. The wisest of men becomes fools or clowns in Shakespearean tragedy. Hamlet is a very wise person. He is the prince. But he has this problem. He's not able to take a decision. A king, a king has to take decisions. If Hamlet is going to become the king, how will he take a decision? So he's inefficient. So he becomes a clown in front of the audience. He is a laughing stock. And that is it. And motive plays a vital role in the tragedy of Shakespeare. Motive is one particular element that plays an important role in the turning, as a turning point in the tragedies of Shakespeare. So these are the important aspects of Shakespeare's plays. If you want to, Hamlet is one of the greatest tragedies. I've been talking about Hamlet for some time. So there are a few characters, we may have to remember them by name. The play is set in Denmark. Hamlet is the son. Hamlet is our protagonist. He suffers from procrastination. He can't take decisions. His father is king. His uncle is King Claudius. His mother is Queen Gertrude. Polonius. Ophelia is his lady love. Polonius is a high-ranking staff in the king's court. And Polonius is Ophelia's father. Laertes is Ophelia's brother, and Horatio is an important is his friend, Hamlet's friend. They play a very important role in this play. The important aspect is regicide, the killing of the king. This plays an important role in this particular play. And soliloquy. The meaning of soliloquy is one single person talking. Actually, he is talking about his inner feelings when nobody is around on the stage. Of course, the audience do hear it, and the audience understand what is happening in the particular person's mind. So the famous soliloquy of Hamlet is, "To be or not to be." That is also a doubtful condition. Did my uncle cheat or not cheat? So should I kill or not kill? So unable to take a decision. So this is the main flaw of Hamlet that we find in this particular play. So the tragic flaw of Hamlet is procrastination, inability to do things properly, inability to take a decision. So with this particular thing, the play moves on. The plot of the play is Hamlet is in Germany. But he has been summoned to Denmark. He has been called to Denmark. So Denmark is his place. His father is there. He is the king. So he has been called to attend his father's funeral. So his father is dead. He is coming to Denmark from Germany, and he is shocked over his father. Moreover, he is also shocked by his mother's remarriage, immediate remarriage with his uncle Claudius. His father is dead. His father's brother Claudius marries his mother, Hamlet's mother and becomes the king in the place of his father, King Claudius. Suddenly, Claudius becomes the king. So this is a shock for Hamlet. He is the prince of Denmark. So he has a friend by name Horatio, a scholar friend of Hamlet. He is here to check on things. So Claudius is now the new king of Denmark. Claudius is also married to the widow Gertrude, that is Hamlet's mother. So now Hamlet's problem starts with apparition. Apparition means a ghost, the seeming apparition of the old king, that is his father. So the apparition comes and says, I was killed by your uncle and he has married your mother. That is incestuous. That is out of law. That is not within the marital law. So do something, kill your uncle and avenge my murder. So this is the message given by the ghost. Hamlet doesn't immediately react. As a king, prince, he's supposed to have reacted, but he doesn't react. He has his own doubts. So he calls his friend Horatio to check. He calls a servant to check if there is a ghost. What about the ghost? So he is doing a lot of studying situations, studying the ghost, studying what happened and all that, and not taking any decisions. So he has a turbulent mind, totally confused, and Hamlet stands a legal chance to become the heir of the throne, but it is not going to happen because of though he could have become the king of Denmark, his uncle has now become the king of Denmark. Till the death of the uncle, he cannot become the king of Denmark. So this makes Hamlet a lot suspicious and a lot unhappy. And on the other hand, there are a lot of problems. Whenever the ghost appears, Hamlet has to take a decision, but he doesn't do so. It is mainly because of his flaw. Right. So with this, you have a lot of action taking place. And towards the end, Hamlet has to take a stand, and his love for Ophelia, the court advisor Polonius's daughter, is also in a big flux. So one day he confronts, there is a feast put in the court. After the feast, he confronts his mother and questions her about the incestuous, questionable marriage with the uncle Claudius. He wants to find out what was the hurry in her remarrying the uncle soon after her widowhood. When the mother is very angry and she is, there is a lot of angry words being exchanged between the mother and the son. There is a small noise. Polonius is hiding behind a screen and trying to watch what is happening there. Polonius is the court advisor. So Hamlet, in his anger, thinks that it is King Claudius, that is his uncle, who is hiding behind the screen, and kills Polonius. So Polonius is being killed. Now Hamlet will be tried for murder. But once again, Polonius's death angers Polonius's daughter Ophelia. Ophelia drowns. And once again, Laertes, that is Polonius's son. So Laertes comes to avenge his father's death and his sister's drowning. He wants to kill Hamlet. So in the scuffle, once again the ghost appears. Now Hamlet has a doubt. Should he kill his uncle, King Claudius, or should he not kill his uncle, King Claudius? Of course, he also has to take care of himself, because Polonius, the court advisor's son, is also behind him trying to kill him because he has killed his father. So Polonius, so after all this problems, Hamlet, there is a play that is being staged, and towards the end of action, we find that King Claudius tries to kill Hamlet because Hamlet has plans to usurp the throne. Laertes is here to avenge his father's death, and a lot of guards are being killed to keep silence. And Laertes and Hamlet in a scuffle, Laertes is being killed, Hamlet is alive. but he has already been stabbed. And under sword point, he forces his uncle King Claudius to consume a poisoned drink that was kept ready for Hamlet. And his mother Gertrude is also killed. So towards the end of the play, we see a very strong action sequence, the gravedigger scene. The gravedigger scene in Shakespeare's Hamlet is a very important one, where you find a gravedigger digging lots of graves, because there are so many corpses, bloodied corpses on the stage, and everybody is waiting to bury the corpse and the action to take place, to come to a conclusion towards the end. So this is the denouement that Shakespeare provides us towards the end of the play. So till the end, Hamlet, if Hamlet had taken a right decision at the right time, all the tragedy, all the death would have been stopped. But unfortunately, Hamlet's inability to take a decision ends with almost all of them dead. His uncle is dead, his uncle the king is dead. So his mother Gertrude has a drink from the poisoned cup, which was actually kept for Hamlet. She is also dead. And Laertes also has mortally wounds Hamlet. And Laertes is also dying. And Claudius, of course, is being attacked finally by Hamlet, made to drink the poison cup, and he also dies. So what happens at the end is that nothing creative or nothing productive has come out of this particular action. So a tragedy is the tragedy that Shakespeare's Hamlet provides to the audience is a complete tragedy, with the death, with not just one death but several deaths that we find with the gravedigger scene. So that's the concluding that's the concluding scene of Hamlet. And revenge is the basis of the entire tragedy that takes place in Shakespeare's Hamlet. So revenge as a motive is a very important thing. Regicide or killing of the king is the first one that triggers this revenge. So Hamlet, in his aim to take revenge, actually ends up killing so many people, directly or indirectly. And the protagonist's inner conflict is an important aspect in Hamlet. And we find that Hamlet is constantly in conflict. Hamlet is constantly not taking decisions. Rather, he is full of conflict and nothing gets done in Hamlet's case. So the last scene of Hamlet, the gravedigger scene, is very important. Where the gravedigger scene is a visual representation of the horror of revenge. It's a total bloodbath. It's full of melodrama. Practically, it cannot happen. But given Shakespeare's ability to, provide melodramatic characters, melodramatic situations, we find that it is a total bloodbath that we see at the end of the play. Hamlet also dies. That is one thing. So the tragic protagonist is not alive. The psychological ambivalence of the hero is another important aspect of a revenge tragedy. There is a lot of conflict, psychological conflict within the protagonist. Protagonist is the main character. And the existentialism, that is doubt, living in doubt of human life. So there is a lot of doubt that is surrounding the existence of almost all the characters. Gertrude buries her husband, the king, and immediately remarries his brother. So what was the clarity that she had in mind that no one knows? Hamlet very clearly knows that his father was killed, of course, by the ghost. As audience, we see that, we find that only from the ghost. But he's not able to take a decision. He wants to avenge his father. He is very angry. But he is angry, but is he taking a decision? No. So this inability, this doubtfulness is the basis of his tragedy. And Polonius, the court advisor, knows that his daughter is in love, Ophelia is in love with Hamlet. But that doesn't stop him from spying on... That doesn't stop him from spying on Hamlet. And of course, he is also killed. And Ophelia is once again, she's a pathetic character in this particular action.